Tele grande.
Summer days, afternoons at the park. Gentlemen, is there anything better than being a senior in high school?
Nope. I just want to sit here and do nothing all day long.
I haven't done anything for the last 2 weeks.
Yep.
How was math yesterday?
Good one, John. But seriously, when do you guys want to get working on the final episode of Telegrande?
We don't even have to do that much work. I mean, we already have the movies all set up, don't we?
Yeah, right. John, you were going to have a new Spinko, right?
I have a confession to make, guys.
Yes, my son?
The Spinko episode that I was talking about before is not going to happen.
It all went down one fateful day. I was just sitting, studying my physics, minding my own business, wasn't paying attention. I guess Spinko must have walked across the page, because when I closed the book, all I saw was a green blob.
John, how could you do that to Spinko?
Well, Dan, the thing of it is, Dan, like, everyone at school and all the people who watch Telegrande think John's, like, this nice, sweet guy.
Yeah.
But, like, you remember that time that we went over his house that time to play marbles?
Oh, yeah.
That Weimar Republic deal we worked out?
That was terrible.
It made him even more angry.
I know.
This is not him.
John!
Oh my god, he's doing it again.
March now! Incoming! Certainty! March now!
Oh my god.
Why does everything he does have to be so political?
John, can we please just play a regular old friendly game of marbles for once?
Friendly? Ah, friendly! Nein! Mach schnell! Setzen Sie!
What the? John, listen, your first problem is that Africa is all wrong.
Nein! Schweinhunde! Mein Afrikaner will be so! Move!
Why?
We begin in Europe!
What is he talking about?
It's something about position. He's very territorial.
Behold! Mein Shooter Army! Die Shooterwaffe! The games have begun!
Thank you.
John, you just got that marble. Mon, are you going to take it?
Nein! Mein Schildwaffe will accept no swirlies!
We are getting absolutely slaughtered.
Just kill us out there.
Yes.
It's making it so much harder.
It is so much harder. But what are we gonna do?
We gotta just stage a single attack at the heart of his evil empire. And just take him out in one fell swoop. That's the only way to do it.
But where?
Normandy.
You have returned just in time to see me take the North African front.
Nein!
Slow motion. I said I'm out of here. I'm out of here.
But you guys! You guys! Why do you always have to be the allies?
From now on, let's just stick to hopscotch.
That was just the end.
Speaking of which, hopscotch, my house, 3 o'clock tomorrow afternoon. You there?
Yeah.
I'm in.
John, I mean, you're a little arrogant.
What do you mean? Look, not everybody thinks I'm the worst ever. You know that, like, most of the school is, like, completely enamored of me. I think we should make the final episode about how I'm the coolest guy in school.
That kid needs to get it through his head that he's John Davies and not John Travolta.
We should confront him.
Yeah, face to face.
Because he's got to learn that educational access television is not the be-all end-all of stardom.
This coming from Mr. Movie Review?
Shut up.
And so I said to him, no way, man, am I taking your lousy 10 grand when I'm worth what, like 20, 25,000 grand? Am I right here?
Yeah, easily, John.
Yeah. At least, if not more.
Right. So that is why I'm hiring an agent to handle this kind of junk.
John, I hate to put it so bluntly, but you're really not that famous.
I mean, what are you talking about?
Well, like, you're not a movie star.
I hate to get technical, but technically, you haven't even been in a feature film.
Yeah.
As soon as we're done the final episode of Tele Grande, your fame's pretty much just gonna die with the show.
Yeah, buddy.
You're nothing! Nothing!
Look, you two fly-by-nights obviously just don't remember my 50-year Hollywood career or my 1968 Mr. Universe Championship. You remember this one?
1968, Mr. Universe, huh? Mm-hmm. There's only one little problem. You're only 18! Okay. Yeah. Okay.
John, you're only 18 years old.
Then explain to me, Smarty, how I appeared in each of the following feature films.
Shall be yours. Push him in.
I claim the right of a Viking to die with a sword in my hand.
And I deny you that right. Go ahead. Push him in.
Cut my bonds and give me the sword.
Why should I?
You deny me the right to enter Valhalla?
You're not fooling anyone, Mr. Bender. The next screw that falls out is gonna be you.
Eat my shorts.
What's that?
Eat my shorts.
You just bought yourself another Saturday, mister.
Oh, I'm crushed.
You just bought one more, right there.
I'm free the Saturday after that. Beyond that, I'm gonna have to check my calendar.
Good, because it's gonna be filled. We'll keep going. You want another one? Say the word. Instead of going to prison, you'll come here. Are you through?
No.
I'm doing society a favor.
So?
That's another one right there. I've got you for the rest of your natural-born life if you don't watch your step. You want another one?
Yes.
You got it. You got another one right there. That's another one, pal.
Cut it out!
Are you through?
Not even close, bud.
Good. You got another one right there.
Do you really think I give a poop?
Another. You through?
Well, how many is that?
You're mine, Bender. For 2 months, I gotcha. I have something here for you. I wanted you to have it when you were old enough, but your uncle wouldn't allow it. Feared you might follow old Swisher on some damn fool idealistic crusade like your father did.
Sir, if you'll not be needing me, I'll close down for a while.
Sure, go ahead. What is it?
Your father's lightsaber. It's the weapon of a Jedi Knight. Not as clumsy or random as a blaster. An elegant weapon for a more civilized age. For over 1,000 generations, the Jedi Knights were the guardians of peace and justice in the Old Republic. Before the Dark Times. Before the Empire.
That's the one, dude.
She doesn't look like a freshman.
Sophomore, dude. Sophomore. Fully aged sophomore me.
We do the bus together.
You talk to her?
Talk, dude. I have a relationship with her.
Figures in like 17 digits.
You are such a liar.
We'll see about that, my man. I predict that by night's end, me and her will interface. Check it out.
Pretty intense, huh? Over.
More X to the max. Over.
Who's the guy?
Andrew Ehrlitz. He's in my class.
Oh. Your boyfriend?
I don't know. I guess he's okay.
He seemed a little short.
He's 12 years old, Willie.
Oh, right. So he's not really... Right. So tell me something. What do you kids, what is it you do kids your age, on the weekends?
What we've been doing lately is smoking massive amounts of drugs, binging on Entenmann's, and listening to old Pink Floyd CDs.
Really?
You are flavored today.
Oh, you're kidding. Right.
The Entenmann's part was true.
Oh. So you like this guy, Andrew?
He's okay. He's into male contraception, which is nice for a change. Joking. You really gotta chill, Will.
Right.
I'm gonna go inside. You sure you're gonna be okay?
I'll be okay.
Good.
Hey, Natalie Portman?
Yes.
I heard somewhere that if you love something, you should let it go. So if you leave now, that means you'll love me forever.
Bye.
Yes.
So, what do you have to say now, hotshots?
John, none of that stuff ever happened.
Yeah, it did.
No, it didn't. Those films were created independent of yourself. You only put yourself into them after.
So, that's just as good.
It isn't, really. People know the difference between you and Mark Hamill.
Not many.
The point is, Luke, you have to stop acting like a movie star. Quite frankly, it's making Tele Grande look bad.
That's
worse.
I'm sorry, guys. I didn't know it was affecting the show so much.
Well, that's all right, kiddo. You just have to promise that from now on, you'll keep your head out of the stars. And you can...
Whatever it is, Chris, I agree. Dan, I'm sorry about the confusion. Russ, nice hat. I gotta run.
John, you better not cue that song.
I won't, don't worry.
He's gonna do it.
Don't do it, John.
He's gonna do it.
John?
I don't think that's a viable option.
Why not?
I mean, you can't just make the whole episode all about yourself.
Well, look, I don't see you coming up with any better ideas, Dan. I mean, like, have you made a movie recently?
Yep.
People, August 4th is just another day in the long march of summer. Just another hot, muggy night you spend sweating in bed, wondering why you never got around to buying air conditioning. To me, August 4th is something much more. It marks a milestone in my life, erected in the twilight of my adolescence. August 4th is the day my life changed forever.
best of friends. Looking back on it, I am still amazed at how close we all were. It seemed then like we had been friends forever and always would be. But things would change.
So, Jack, are you ready?
Yeah.
Rick was a leader. He had always been the one to take control of the situation. Our group had four. The two others were Ann and Max. Well, Rick and Ann had grown up together. They were next-door neighbors. They always did everything together, the closest two friends could be. I envied them. Each year, the two families went up to a cottage on the Cape for the annual Lomax Smith family vacation. It seemed like a fun time. They would always come back with stories about this and that place that no one understood but them. The caravan would be leaving for this year's festivities tomorrow night on the Red Eye.
I called Max. He said for us to pick him up.
Yeah, sure. Jack, have you noticed anything different about him?
Yeah, he seems a bit depressed.
What, more than usual?
No, really.
I don't know. I mean, I don't see it.
I can't wait till tomorrow.
Neither can I. I can't wait to see the boat.
Remember that time
when... Hello? Left out in the back seat here.
I'll go get Max.
Max was also leaving the next day. He was headed off to a basketball camp in Portland. Max's father was a stuff of legend as far as high school basketball was concerned. His name hung up on the wall in our school's gym. Max had it from the start. His father wouldn't let him play any other sport than basketball, and Max hated it. Anyway, he had never been good at the game to begin with. The worst part was that we were going to be seniors next year, so it would be Max's last chance to make varsity. That's why Max's dad forked over the $2,000 to send him to Portland. The plane left at 7 the next morning.
So you really don't notice anything different?
No, I don't. Listen, can we just talk about something else?
It just feels like we're casting him out.
How's that?
Well, whenever he asks me out somewhere, like to get something to eat, it's just really weird without Rick. Jack?
Yeah?
Never mind. I'm gonna go see what's taking them so long.
That leaves me. I didn't really want to spend the rest of my summer feeling sorry for myself, so I decided to get a job at the local supermarket. I figured if I wasn't going to do anything this summer, I might as well get paid not to. Besides, I would have the last laugh when school came around and everyone asked me for money.
Let the festivities commence.
Yay!
Something was very wrong. I didn't know what went on in Max's house, but something happened. Max looked like he didn't want to be there, like someone dragged him out. In his face, there was something alien, like I was looking at a completely different person. At the time, I didn't know what was wrong. All I had to go on was a tense feeling that something was happening, which I could not recognize, much less control. The wheels had already been set in motion. There was no turning back.
Oh, Jesus, I left my money back at the house. Do you mind if I go back and get it?
I mind you getting it less than I mind paying for you.
It'll only take a minute.
Oh, my dad wanted me to ask you what to bring for the boat.
I don't know. Why don't you come in?
Okay.
What's wrong?
Why is everybody asking me that?
I don't know. You just seem a little depressed.
Right? I bet you've been talking to Rick.
Yeah, he just said he was a little worried about you.
What does he think I am? Some kid? I don't need to be worried over. Besides, I wouldn't listen to Rick. I'd like to see the stupid plan he has for tonight.
You mean you didn't want to hang out tonight with us?
No, it's just...
I don't know.
We just do the same stuff every weekend. We never hang out with other people, never talk to anyone else. I mean, it's not you or anything.
Rick was right. There was something different about Max. He seemed passive, defeated. His fighting spirit was gone. Before that night, I'd say he was the most defensive of our group. But his passion and xenophobia were gone. He had battled all of his life against what he feared, and now he was tired, lying on the hood of the car like a boxer leans on the ropes. I should have said something, done something, but I didn't. I didn't know why Max changed, but he had, and he would never be the same.
Packaged crap is this?
Shut up, Max.
No, you shut up.
Have a little fun.
Yeah, sure. Have a little fun, Max. As long as it agrees with you.
Stop it.
What are you talking about?
You, Rick. I'm sick of living by your rules.
Guys, stop. You think I tell you how to live?
Yeah, maybe not directly, but you always assume control.
Guys!
If I don't assume, who will?
Me!
Anne.
No, Rick, Max is right. You do take over.
Oh, hey, I got an idea. Let's all gang up on me.
Hey, let's let Max call the shots tonight.
Fine.
It was a hasty decision, and one I would regret. There's an old lake in the park near the bay. Well, the Hudson, that is. We taught Max how to ice skate there. I guess it was the memory he wanted to remember us by when we were on better terms. Taking us to the pond was his last effort to pick up the pieces which had been shattered.
Do you remember that old fisherman?
The one that lost his pole?
Yep, he was just sitting there, and then, bloop, the fish just took the thing right out of his hands. I felt kind of bad for him, but it was funny.
That was the funniest thing I've ever seen.
I'm cold.
So am I. Hey, Max.
Yeah?
Let's go get in the car and warm up.
I thought I was calling the shots tonight.
Come on, it's cold out here. Let's go bowling or something.
I don't like bowling.
Oh, come on. Yes, you do.
Oh, that's right, Rick. You know me better than I do. I forgot.
You know what your problem is?
Rick, don't.
Deep down inside, you like being angry. And you want everyone to feel sorry for you.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and you can't stand that. I don't give you sympathy.
Oh, that's right, Rick. I'm sorry. It's all my fault, okay? Please guide me with your sympathy.
Those are my keys!
That's right. And if you want to find them, you're going to need help. And Jack and I aren't going to help you until you start getting along.
I didn't mind being spoken for. It was a good idea. I wouldn't have thought of it myself. Unfortunately, it didn't work like everything else that night. Anne didn't have much of a throwing arm. With the aid of a candle, Rick found the keys pretty quickly. When we all got back in the car, it was completely silent. No one said a word until we got to town, and that was a 20-minute drive.
No, Rick and I already ate.
You, Jack?
Yeah, sure, I'll come.
Hey, Max, how's it going?
Oh, hey, Bill. How's your summer been?
Great. And even better, next year, seniors.
Yeah, that is definitely true.
So, you been practicing?
Yeah. You know how much I need it.
Listen, there's no reason why you should have to practice alone. A couple of guys and I get together every Saturday morning and play basketball at the park. Why don't you come?
I don't know. I'd probably just get in the way.
Listen, That's the only way you're gonna get better.
I can't anyway. I'm going to basketball camp tomorrow.
Wow, that sounds great.
Yeah.
Well, listen, there's no reason why you can't practice with us during the fall.
I guess you're right.
So why don't you give me a call when you get back, and we'll get together.
Okay.
Word.
See you, Bill.
Well, listen, there's a party at Hank's tonight. Why don't you come?
No thanks.
Listen, if you don't make the effort, they won't. Come on, it'll be a good time.
I can. I promised my friends I'd hang out with them.
I think you could use a little break from your friends.
Jack.
Yeah?
Listen, I'm not coming back with you.
Somehow, I couldn't turn around to face him. I couldn't stand to look into his eyes. The most I could manage was his reflection.
I was invited to a party. And I thought I'd go. Besides, I'm only making you guys miserable.
That's not true.
No, it is, Jack. Face it. Tell Ann, will you?
Max is,
That's right. We already saw him leave.
It felt like someone was pushing against my chest. I'd been such a fool. I shouldn't have let Max call the shots that night. Had I not tried to save things from falling apart, Max would have gone home, gone up to his room, slammed the door, and then he would have cursed and broke stuff, because that was Max. Then he would have gone off to camp and wallowed in his own self-pity till he realized it wasn't worth it. That was the normal way of things in the world, according to Max. But I had to tempt fate, and I lost. We all did. I didn't know from where Rick got the idea to go on, but he insisted we go to the driving range. We used to go there with Max all the time. The first time we went, Max hit the 200-yard sign. From then on, we made it a tradition that whoever hit the sign would be treated to dinner. Max and Rick were even at two apiece. Neither Ann nor I had ever hit it. And so we began to drive.
What's wrong?
I'm tired.
It was bound to happen sometime, Jack.
What?
Max.
Yeah, I guess.
Listen, I don't see why we can't just act like before.
You're right.
I wasn't in the mood to fight. Besides, at the time, she did have a point.
I'm off tonight.
What's new about that?
Oh, very funny. You want to try?
I do believe it's time for you to watch and learn.
Aren't we confident?
Right, laugh now, but it'll be sweeter when you're buying me dinner.
It's a shame when people get delusions of grandeur.
Oh, we'll see.
That's baseball!
Shut up! Ow!
Maybe it was a crisp night air. Maybe my senses were attracted to tragedy after Max left. Regardless of what it was obvious that things had changed. I saw something different in the way Rick reacted, something more than friendship. I now saw everything clearly and in perfect contrast, like the golf balls we hit sailing through the night sky. Anna tried to tell me when we were picking up Max. I guess she was probably trying to tell me for a long time. I'm sure Rick didn't want me to know. And he had a good reason not to. This changed everything.
I want to go.
I had to go home, to get away. I wanted this night to end as quickly as possible. Then maybe the next morning would be all right. I thought Max may not have fit in at the party. Maybe Bill brought him there to make fun of him. But there would be no message waiting for me on my machine when I got home. And the next morning would provide no relief.
Jack, what's wrong?
Look, I'm stopping.
I wanted them to shut up. Just shut up.
Jack, what the hell is wrong with you?
I had to get out. I had to run away from everything. Dawn was beginning to break. If I could only get home, everything would be fine.
Jack!
Jack! Come on, Jack. Stay here.
Get off of me!
I'm not letting you go till you explain yourself.
I don't have to explain myself to you. I'm not the one going behind my friend's backs all this time, you two are.
It's only been a year.
Why'd you have to lie to me for so long?
You didn't have to know.
Damn it, I did have to know. Do you know what it's going to be like now? I'm going to be the third wheel, Rick.
You're overreacting.
Like hell I'm overreacting. Maybe we could have done it with Max, but now it's just going to be me and you two. I might as well go it alone.
Stop taking this to the extreme.
That's easy for you to say. You still have somebody. I'm by myself.
Why are you insisting that this is the end of the world?
You know, Max was right about you. All you think about is yourself, your happiness. Is that why you outcasted him?
I didn't do anything to Max.
You knew he liked Dan. What was the matter? Did you think he was a threat?
I was never less than a friend to you. Jack? Jack! Oh. We never did anything wrong.
I greeted dawn with a sigh of relief. The night was over and I could finally go on. It's been a long time since that August 4th, 20 years ago. After high school, Max went to the UCLA campus, but he never took any classes. I went to the University of Toronto and became an architect. I married and moved away. Ann and Rick married each other and opened an antique store in town. They did reasonably well. When I brought my kids to visit my parents in the summer, I stopped by the store and said hello. It was strange and uncomfortable, especially between Rick and me. But we lived in a small town, and I would have felt bad if Ann found out I'd been in town and had not visited. One day, Max called my house out in Vancouver. He must have gotten my number from my mother. My wife took a message from him. He told me he was in town that summer and he wanted to come see me. I still knew his number by heart, but I never returned the call.
I gotta tell you, that movie was an awful derivative. Like, you stole every single thing in the script.
From where?
Like, Dawson's Creek, maybe? Hello? Felicity, yeah. Much?
Sorry.
It's bull. I didn't steal anything. I don't steal anything.
Dan, you steal everything. Don't you remember that time you got arrested at Suburban Square?
Yeah.
you ran away from that poor gentleman, just like you ran away from me after I confronted you about how you stole my identity for all those months.
Oh, so sorry, Chris. I'm sorry if I can't be just like you, if I can't be like, what, 8 feet tall and lift like 9 bazillion pounds, and that I wasn't raised by some single male dog and yet was still able to successfully reintegrate with society. Oh, I'm so sorry about that one. Oh, and while I'm at it, I can't fly too, sorry. And that, like, maybe it's all right for me if my best friend isn't DMX and I'm not one of the Rough Riders. Sorry, Chris.
Dan, I guess you're right, but so long as we're talking about my perfection, I've got the best idea for the final episode of Tele Grande. You see, it starts off just like any other episode. Hello, and welcome to Tele Grande, your weekly film fest show. I'm Chris Swisher, here with my co-host,
John Davies.
And we're here to bring you... Yes, John?
The final episode of Tele Grande. We've got some excellent movies for you this week. We've got a kung fu movie made by Keith Wilkinson. We've got some stop animation. There's an unending list here, folks. But without any further ado, what Dan just appeared in the middle of that room, and what is he wearing? It's futuristic. What is he wearing?
Dan, where have you been all this time? You haven't hosted Tele Grande for months. What's going on here?
Yeah, I know. But John, Chris. Something terrible will befall Tele Grande before the end of this episode. I know. I've come from the future. I've seen...
The future? Dan, what are you talking... Something terrible? What's with these clothes?
John, there's no time to explain now. But don't worry. I will be back.
Whoa! Oh. Wow! Did you see that? Dan disappeared into thin air before our very eyes. That was the most unbelievable.
Folks, why don't we get to this first movie? I think it's by...
John, are you kidding? Dan just came from the future with a message of utter doom for the final episode of Tele Grande. And you would just go to the next movie? You know it's just some piece of crap you guys made in your basement last week. Who are you kidding, man?
Well, Chris, I guess when you put it that way, there's really no reason why we shouldn't postpone the show to find out what kind of doom awaits us. I mean, it's only going to take 25 minutes, so we can just watch some...
25 minutes? Doom comes in 25 minutes? Final episode of Tele Grande? Doom comes to the final episode of Tele Grande? Let's get to work!
All right. You guys know what kind of doom is going to befall us here on the final episode of Tele Grande?
Flesh will be liquefied.
Flesh, huh?
I heard it was some kind of baking accident.
Tragic cookies.
Does this have anything to do with 90-degree weather, gym class, and Mr. Carson?
It's been happening for a while. I've seen it. You kind of saw it in Alien when the android started to short-circuit.
What's Tele Grande?
There's just been too much pressure. I don't think John can handle it. I got this vision of him sort of keeling over away from the editing decks, hitting his head on the floor, his ears spinning around, and out of his mouth comes this black tape. That's all of this SVHS tape, and it's just spewing all over, and his eyes are rolling back in his head, and it's just too much. And then Dan comes in, and he picks it up, flips it off, and he says, "This is perfect. This is just what we need." That's how I see it ending.
Now, what sort of doom do you think is going to befall us here on the final episode of Tele Grande?
I don't know. I don't want it to end.
Terrorists will break in, you know.
Ted Kachuk live on camera.
What can I do?
Nothing.
See? She's the doom. She is the doom.
Okay. I'll be the doom. That's good.
More than at any other time in our history, mankind faces a crossroads. One path leads to despair and utter hopelessness, the other to total extinction. Let us pray that we have the wisdom to choose correctly.
Do you know what sort of doom is going to happen here on the final episode of Tele Grande?
I think it's all been in one big dream. Or nightmare.
I speak, by the way, not with any sense of futility, but with a panicky conviction of the absolute meaninglessness of existence that could easily be misinterpreted as pessimism. It is not. It is merely a healthy concern for the predicament of modern man.
What sort of doom do you think is going to befall?
This is the library.
Sorry.
What sort of doom do you think is going to befall us in the final episode of Telegrande?
You guys are going to sink faster than the Titanic.
Curses.
I have a feeling it has to do with the destruction of large pieces of porcelain.
I've heard something about the sky falling, Chris. I don't know.
Chicken.
I think you will all founder in a collapsing ecosystem of Harding's Run.
Gentlemen, what sort of doom would you say is going to befall us here on the final episode of Telegrande?
Some sort of flesh-eating bacteria.
I'm going to say some sort of large fallen mammal.
I really don't know what's going to happen. I really don't. I don't know why, but I just don't.
To be something wonderful.
It is wonderful. That you're making it wonderful by answering this question.
Oh, good.
Yeah. All right. So
and that's what I wanted.
Yeah. Right.
And that's all recorded, I hope, because I'm hoping that it isn't doom and gloom, but it's something glorious for my wonderful heroes from Telegrande. Can it be so?
Well, I think something sort of like, I don't know, one of those meteor movies. It's going to come down and wipe you out.
By any chance, do you ladies have any idea what sort of doom is going to befall us here on the final episode of Telegrande?
No.
I know.
Accelerated hair loss.
You might forget all your Spanish. And then what? What will be left?
Si no hablan español, sería una tragedia, una verdadera tragedia. Adiós.
I think that Dan will turn into a giant carrot, and
I'm gonna burn you.
So, do you know what sort of terrible fate might befall us at the end of the final episode of Telegrande?
Well, it certainly has been building to a crescendo over the last year or so. I can hardly imagine what would happen, but I do have my own theory. I believe that if you were to mix deuterium and diatomic oxygen with molybdenum, here's what's going to happen. The deuterium and the diatomic oxygen will mix with molybdenum, and you're going to have doomo at the endo.
John, I don't think any of those kids really knew what sort of doom was going to befall us.
No, I agree, Chris. Hopefully, though, we'll see Dan again before it does befall us, this terrible fate.
Absolutely.
Dan! Have you come back again from the future to tell us more about this terrible fate?
No. I just came to the cafeteria to get some crackers. But tell me you two guys are sitting around talking about the doom that's going to befall you again.
This isn't like the last time with that odd, smelly man we met in the city. Dan, this time you yourself came back from the future to tell us that some terrible doom would befall us before the end of the final episode of Telegrande.
Yeah, and you had futuristic clothes on.
Clothes, eh? I'm not so sure I know anything about that. But, you know, those captain's wafers can't wait forever.
Surely this is the most intriguing debacle that has ever plagued Telegrande. The final episode's almost over, we haven't shown a single movie, our co-hosts are traveling through time, and now some, like, terrible fate is going to befall us, and we don't even know how to stop it. This is terrible, John.
Well, oh well, I guess there's only one thing to do, and that, Chris, is to sign off. Telegrande, away.
Look! Dan has once again returned from the future to warn us.
Chris, John, things aren't as they seem. The person who will cause your downfall is in that cafeteria right now.
Dan? You're saying that you, the Dan of the future, have come back in time to tell us that your past self is going to destroy Telegrande before the end of the final episode? Are you guys going to, like, battle it out now in a fight mano a mano that transcends time and space? Because I have to tell you that I think that would look very cool.
Yeah, temporal battle royale, right. Listen, I've been to the future and we still don't have that kind of special effects. But everything else, you have that all wrong too. You know, the person sitting next to you really isn't the past version of myself, but none other than a cleverly disguised Abby Heppy.
It's true. It's true. I disguised myself as Dan so I could sabotage the final episode of Telegrande and pave the way for a glorious new season of Us next year. And I would have done it, too, hadn't been for you meddling kids and your time-traveling co-hosts.
Well, I guess that ties up all the loose ends. But I just have one question. If you were playing Dan Alordigi the whole time, where was the real Dan?
I'm right here.
No. I mean the Dan of present day, I think.
John, I think I can answer that question. If there's anyone I know more than myself, by that I mean the me of the past, which to you will be the Dan of the present. No, well, it doesn't matter anyway. I know that a goal for the Dan of the present has always been to steal the identity of Chris Swisher. John, I suggest you turn around because the co-host you know is not as he seems.
Ah!
Damn. Yeah, it's me, Dan. You know, ever since I've been a little kid, it's been my lifelong dream to imitate the part of Chris Swisher so well that no one could tell it was me. But alas, my plans have been foiled by you meddling co-hosts and my time-traveling self.
Well, I guess this only leaves one question. Where's the real Chris Swisher?
John, co-hosts, supervillainesses, TV viewers. I wish I could say that the answer to that question were an easy one. But sometimes in life, there are no easy answers. And some mysteries are better left
to the future. Well, guys, what do you think?
Time travel? Doom, Chris? I want to see Natalie Portman, all right?
Oh, Mr. Movie Star, Natalie Portman. We got to have time travel.
Natalie Portman.
Guys, you know what the problem is? There's just too much talking. I want to see some action. You know what? Maybe this isn't such a good idea.
Guys, the senseless fighting in this final episode is tearing us apart.
Yeah. You know what? I think we should just do what we do every week.
Make ourselves look cool.
That's what I've been saying the whole time.
Well then.
Not time to make a change. Just relax, take it easy. You're still young, that's your fault. There's so much you have to know. Find a girl, settle down. If you want, you can marry. Look at me, I am old, but I'm happy. I was like you are now, and And I know that it's not easy to be calm when you found something going on. But take your time, think a lot. Why, think of everything you've got, for you will still be here tomorrow, but your dreams may not. How can I try to explain? When I do, he turns away again. It's always been the same, same old story. From the moment I could talk, I was ordered to listen. Now there's a way, and I know that I have to go away. I know I have to go. Change, just sit down, take it slowly. You're still young, that's your fault. There's so much you have to go through. Find a girl, settle down. If you want, you can marry. Look at me, I am old, but I'm happy. Keeping all the things I knew inside. It's hard, but it's harder to ignore it. If they were right, I'd agree. But it's them they know, not me. Now there's a way, and I know that I have to go away. I know I have to go.
Life is so bad.